Hello folks, it's Thursday, and today I'm going to talk about blockchain security. Not in a ton of detail, but we're going to overview some of the main considerations when you think about blockchains and you think about, is it secure, and how do I know if it is going to be secure going forward? So I've split security into three different levels. So we've got the protocol level, and that is more what you would actually expect when you think about cybersecurity or when you think about security of a network system. But then equally as important, we have personal security, and then sort of one that maybe isn't considered as often will be community level security. So starting with the protocol level security, we have here things that always need to be considered, like a denial of service attack and a Sybil attack. Specifically with blockchains though, we cannot allow a double spend attack. And so this is the first problem that had to be overcome when developing a digital currency, was how to prevent somebody from spending the same coins twice or in multiple places. So if your blockchain or your currency doesn't prevent double spending, then it's really no good at all, and you need to go back to the drawing board. I've got this split further into proof of work and proof of stake. So a proof of work currency is exposed to a 51% attack and also various mining attacks, which we'll just label as selfish mining, meaning that the miner is acting selfishly and not contributing to the good of the whole network. On the proof of stake side, we have sort of many more attacks, and this list is actually not even exhaustive. These are, I think, just the main ones that I will try to mention a little bit about today. In the personal bubble, we've got keys and multi-sig and wallets, so I'll come back to this. And then in the community level as well, what happens with the developers? What happens with the miners? What about smart contracts? And then exchanges and scams. So I've labeled all of these as community because they are security issues that need to be considered, but they're maybe not personal security issues, and they're also not protocol or code level issues where bugs in the code or malicious code could end up harming the network. So a denial of service attack, or a DDoS, a distributed denial of service attack, basically involves one attacker here, and what you're going to do is you're going to target a server and you're going to send a request to the server. So in this diagram here, from my machine, go through the internet, send a request to the server, and now a simple request like an HTTP post request could actually, if you have a large message body or you send the bytes really slowly, then that post request on the server is going to take a long time to respond because the server is going to wait for that whole message to come in. And of course, it's very cheap to send a message. So you can send, you know, write a script and send hundreds or thousands of messages into the server. And what you're just going to do is tie up the server's resources, and you're going to occupy that server. And if the server is busy, then it's not going to be able to respond to other appropriate requests from, you know, real users that need the system. Now, from a defense point of view, if you are a system admin and you're being targeted, then one way to handle a denial of service attack is to just shut down the incoming IP of whoever is spamming you with all these requests. And so, from the offensive point of view, the way around that is to distribute your attack through either these various handlers or even at another level through compromised machines. So you may have heard of the term of a botnet, and that involves, you know, many, many machines across the internet that have been compromised at some point in the past, suddenly becoming active, and then all of them from different locations are now spamming or denying service to that target. And a DDoS, or a distributed denial of service, is much harder to stop because of all the different locations the requests are coming in from. And you may not know which ones are legitimate and which ones are not. So a blockchain as an open system must be resilient against a denial of service attack, because anyone can join the system at any time, and anyone can join the system and continually send requests or messages or transactions into the system. And so the system needs to be resilient, needs to be able to handle these requests and basically process them. So in terms of something like Bitcoin, well, it just gets too expensive because of transaction fees to continue to attack or spam the network. And so most people wouldn't be able to do this. Of course, there's a little bit of economics at play here. If you do have a lot of money to burn, perhaps you could slow down the network or deny service to people that really want to use the network because of all the transactions that you're sending. Of course, you'd be paying for access to them. You'd be paying in transaction fees. Next up is a Sybil attack. And a Sybil attack involves, I've got a little diagram over here. A Sybil attack involves a single attacker creating multiple identities of themselves. Not really of themselves, but digital copies that they can then use to attack or spam a system. A Sybil attack often involves reputation of a network. And so a simple example here involves a disgruntled customer creating multiple online accounts and then using all those different accounts to leave bad reviews of a restaurant. And so for the neutral customer coming in or the new user coming into the system, you know, it looks like this restaurant has terrible reviews. You know, it has 20 or 30 bad reviews just in the last month alone. Well, really, that's not indicative of the overall performance. That's only because one person created multiple identities of themselves or Sybils and then used all those identities to attack, in this case, the restaurant. So for a blockchain, a Sybil attack, well, it still involves creating multiple identities and then going after the network. But for a blockchain like Bitcoin or Ethereum, you have to pay to access the network through transaction fees. And so creating multiple Sybils in order to gain either more hash power or in order to try to achieve more of the block reward, well, you're actually going to end up just dividing up your resources as it is into smaller proportions in order to attack the network that way. And so both these blockchains are resilient against a Sybil attack because of the price, the pay to play that's involved there to access the network. A double spend attack we've already talked about in the past, so I won't go into any detail about that here. Two specific attacks related to a proof of work blockchain are the 51% attack, and closely related to that is the selfish mining attack. The 51% attack means that an attacker or a group or a conglomerate of miners achieve 51% of the hash power or the computing power in the total network. For a proof of stake 51% attack, the attackers or the group would need 51% of the stake tokens that are secured by the network. Now, once you have over 51%, of course, that's a majority figure, then what you can do is you can start to guide the consensus. So block rewards and publishing of the new block is decided randomly, and the distribution should be proportional to those that have set number of miners or computing power in the network. So if you have a lot of mining power, then you will receive proportionally more block rewards than those that do not. Now, Bitcoin is such a big network and the hash rate is incredibly high right now. We can see here the total hash rate here, 121 little m or terahashes, 121 million terahashes per second. So that's the total hash rate. Now, if we look at how that's distributed in the whole network, we can see here that these are mining pools. So F2 pool right now over the last 4 days is the biggest pool. It has found 119 of the blocks, followed by Poolin and Ant Pool, BTC.com, unknown and smaller fractions of the total network. And if we just look at this pie chart, we can see that F2 2 pool does not have over half of the total hash power, but there's nothing to stop F2 from joining forces with Poolin, from joining with Ant Pool, and then in total having, you know, a large fraction of the hash power in the network. So how you can guide consensus is you can start building on older blocks. You can fork the chain, start building on an older block, and then if you have the majority, what you're going to do is you're going to catch up and overpass the longest chain, and your new guided version of consensus would then be the canonical blockchain. Now, because such an enormous amount of computing power is required in Bitcoin, it's very, very unlikely that someone can go back and rewrite history, but that is kind of how you would do it. Now, these attackers, even if you have a large proportion, these attackers cannot spend other people's coins, and they cannot outright steal any tokens or coins, because that would involve breaking the cryptography that secures somebody's keys. And so an attacker cannot do that, but they can guide consensus. Another danger when groups or mining pools or even individuals that control a large portion of tokens, a danger when they start to have a large percentage of tokens or hash power is that they can start to censor transactions. So if over half of the transactions have to go through one mining pool, then the network is no longer censorship resistant, and you could even miners could even start blacklisting certain addresses, or you could blacklist based on regions and things like this. And so this is one of the difficulties in a distributed system, is how to keep it distributed, how to prevent a small percentage of participants from gaining a large percentage of influence. Selfish mining is a slightly different strategy, a bit more nuanced. In 2014, some computer scientists from Cornell published a study that you only needed actually a third of the hash power to be more profitable than if you were just contributing as normal to the whole network. So if you have, a third is still a large fraction, but if you have that much hash power, what you can do is you can mine selfishly or secretly without broadcasting. And in the short term, you're going to take a bit of a hit because those blocks aren't being sent out to the network and you're not getting that block subsidy. But if you can mine a couple blocks secretly and then get ahead of the main chain, you can publish them, and now your new short-term fork becomes the main consensus chain. And so in the long term, what you're doing is you're preventing those other maybe two-thirds of honest miners from being in competition with you, and so you can be slightly more profitable this way. Mining dynamics is sort of an interesting crypto economic game that involves maybe a lot of game theoretic variables, and it's, I guess, still early in these systems to determine how they're going to play out overall. Looking now at some proof of stake security considerations, so just specific to a staking blockchain. So first up, we'll have nothing at stake. So if you think about a fork in a blockchain, in a proof of work system, you're incentivized to build on the longest chain. So this is what maintains consensus. And that's because if your chain turns out to be the longest chain, if you've got blocks in there, then you're going to get that block subsidy and earn the reward. Now, in a proof of stake system, there's nothing preventing you from mining on top of forks. It doesn't take a lot of computing power to do so. And what could end up happening is that everybody is just scrambling to build blocks on all of these forks, and nobody is concerned anymore about maintaining consensus or maintaining that longest chain. So in order to incentivize people to contribute just to a single canonical chain, what can be done is that you remove the reward if you happen to publish a block on a fork chain that's not the main chain. And so this is called slashing. So if you slash someone's rewards, then they do not earn them from publishing on any orphan branches or any forks that may take place. Short and long range attacks involve reorganizing the blockchain to the attacker's advantage. Now, the only way to do that is to go back to a certain point in time, find a certain block, and then fork the chain, find new blocks to build on top of that one that you've chosen. So in a proof of work style blockchain, this involves an enormous amount of computing resources because you still have to follow the consensus rules and you still have to find those blocks by hashing individually one by one. Now, if you can do that and catch up to the main chain consensus, then you could double spend some coins and so on and so forth. One measure of security is how long does that take? And there are sort of various estimates in Bitcoin about how long it would take to rewrite the blockchain, and it's a very, very long time. For a proof of stake chain, this is a little bit different because an attacker could acquire a large amount of computational power, dedicate it all to rewriting the history, and in theory, you could catch up more quickly to the main chain consensus. So in the short term, this is sometimes called bribery. So what an attacker could do is bribe a bunch of miners to only add blocks to their forked version of the chain. And if you sort of do the math about how much you're spending in bribes versus how much you're earning either in a double spend or in the new block subsidy, then that could be profitable in the short term. Now, the way to prevent people from doing this is similar to the nothing at stake, is you slash the rewards, or even you could, if they are a validator in the system, you could slash their credentials that allow them to be a validator. So you could penalize them that way. For a long range attack, to prevent someone from going back a reasonable distance and building an entirely new chain starting from that fork, what you can do is you can have successive checkpoints along the way. So after X number of blocks or after X amount of time, you insert a checkpoint into the chain. And what that does is it finalizes all the earlier transactions. And so none of them can possibly be rewritten. And this is what Ethereum 2.0, the Serenity Proof of Stake system, is doing. So there's a checkpointing system such that validators will vote on checkpoint blocks and agree that within a set number of blocks within an epoch, they will decide on one of them to be the checkpoint. And so long range reorganizations back in time before that checkpoint will not be possible. The last one I'll mention is a grinding attack. So a grinding attack, what the attacker is going to do is just try to improve their chances of being selected for minting a new block. Now, how can you improve your chances? Well, you can imagine acquiring a large amount of computing power, and given a certain set of requirements that need to go into a block, what you're going to do is you're going to try to find all of the possible hashes that can meet the requirements. And then you find one that meets the target when the time comes and you publish that one. So if you think about how Bitcoin mining works, you have a nonce in the header and you're going to update or iterate through the nonce values, and that's going to change the hash output. You compare the hash output with your target and then you iterate. And this takes a long time depending on the difficulty and the target, but all you're doing is updating the nonce value in the header. So if you could run through all those possible nonce values ahead of time, or with a large amount of computers running in parallel, and sort of calculate the pre-nonce that is going to meet the requirements, then you could improve your chances of meeting that target. So what's the way around this? Well, if you think about finding new blocks in a blockchain system, usually involves some source of randomness. We need to be able to distribute the rewards fairly. So for Bitcoin, it's finding that hash less than a target. Okay, and for a proof of stake system, well, we're not actually running the hashes up against the limits of computing power, but for a staking system, we still need a source of randomness. And so one way to mitigate this problem is to have the miners work together to then produce a source of randomness that cannot be known in advance. So if you have to work with someone else that you're competing with in order to produce a random seed, that would be able to mitigate this idea of pre-computing these possible hashes in order to find a block. Now, of course, back on the offense here, a group of validators in a staking system could get together and try to collude, and there are some cryptographic methods that can get around this as well, which I won't detail here. You can have a look at the Ethereum Proof of Stake FAQ. So here is the Ethereum wiki, or the FAQ, and it describes some techniques like secret sharing and deterministic threshold signatures, which can help mitigate people colluding in order to grind, including in here a majority beacon, which generates a random number by taking the bit majority of the previous n random numbers generated through some beacon. So the idea is that you cannot know in advance, okay, the information that you need in order to create your block. If you could know in advance the info, then you could game the system a bit and improve your own rewards. Next, I want to get into some personal security considerations, starting with keys. So our cryptographic keys. These either allow you to access the system or allow you to access the tokens in the network. And so it's very important that the private keys are kept private to the best of your ability. So here are some interesting characters. We have the Winklevoss twins here. So these are the guys that co-created Facebook. And then if you've seen the movie The Social Network, or the book by Ben Mezrich, The Social Network, you'll get a little bit more about the story of what happened there. They got a settlement in that Facebook suit, and they basically took that settlement and they dumped a bunch of it into Bitcoin. And now they're Bitcoin billionaires. So the twins have approximately 1% of all the Bitcoin. So that's somewhere around maybe 1,800 Bitcoin. And that at present value is maybe almost $2 billion in Bitcoin. So the private keys to their Bitcoin, you want to keep very, very secure. And it's not even that you need to keep them secure. It's that if you don't have a method to retrieve them safely, then access to whatever they're controlling is gone forever. So lost keys are a big deal. A few estimates out there have between 2 and 4 million Bitcoins have been lost and will never be accessed again unless by some miraculous random stroke of luck, or I'm not sure, they're just lost. So Bitcoin Billionaires, good book. So it describes what these guys did to secure their private keys. So first of all, they generated a random address. So they did this with dice. And they generated their own address in order to store their Bitcoins. And then what they did was they went around to a bunch of safety deposit boxes at banks in America. Of course, those locations are not disclosed. And they also split the keys. So they took their private key, they split it into pieces and put the pieces in different safety deposit boxes in banks around the US. So the idea here is that if one bank gets compromised, you lose only part of the key. And so you have a backup part of that key stored somewhere else. Additionally, if somebody is able to steal that key from one of those vaults, then they don't have enough information in total to rebuild the key. They only have a portion of it. And so this is fairly good practice. What you want to do is split your keys, and you also want to back up your keys. Let's look at some wallet software. Here we have some screenshots from Mycelium. Now, usually when you create an account after you install a wallet, the wallet will be responsible for creating your seed phrase that's derived from your private key. So that key won't be available until you initialize it, usually opening up the wallet for the first time or when you say create a new one. And of course, we get a warning message here. It says you should back up the master seed to restore funds on your HD account if your device is lost or damaged. So if you lose the seed phrase or if you lose the key, there's no recovery. So this is different from a centralized system where usually you can verify your identity and recover your information. In a decentralized system like Bitcoin or Ethereum, if you lose your keys, that's it. Access to whatever tokens they contained is gone. So you should go through and write down those keywords. I think I've got some showing up in a minute here. We can see some of the other functionality. Here's when it says your HD account, it says add HD account, HD accounts. So that means hierarchical deterministic. So hierarchical just means it's in a hierarchy. So you've got sort of a king key at the top, and then you've got your various levels of keys underneath it. And what that is allowing you to do is to have one master key, and then you can create other public key pairs that you can use for transactions, all that are connected to that one. So that's what an HD wallet is, and it's recommended that you use this so that you don't reuse addresses. You want to only use an address as little as possible. And we can see here how you can set your fees. So another feature of most wallets is that they will create transactions for you and then broadcast those transactions to the network. So the wallet is going to store your keys and manage them. Your wallet is going to sign messages and allow you to participate. And the wallet can also, in the same way, send and receive tokens or bitcoins through the network. So if a wallet is doing all of these things, you want to make sure that your wallet software is not compromised and that that's secure. And I'll talk a bit about that in the community level of security. For this wallet, I tried to export my private keys, and as a security measure, I was not able to either screenshot or share my screen. So I tried to share it through a cable to my PC, and I was not able to do that. And I also tried to screenshot it. So I actually had to take a picture of my screen here, which is why it looks a little bit wibbly. But you can see here my private key. So it's this long string of letters. And there are some numbers in there as well. So once this key is out, someone has access to all of the version. So there's a warning message here. Whoever knows this code can spend all your current and future Bitcoin from this account. So this is kind of a unique thing about cryptocurrencies, is that you may not know that you've been hacked or robbed until way further down in the future if you aren't checking, so that you don't get a notification that anything has moved. So someone could come in now anyone that has seen this can come in and sort of sweep these coins or drain this account if anything ever gets deposited in it. Here's another interface. This is an Engine wallet, and this one looks a little bit cleaner. Here I've got an Ethereum account up. So I've got a public address, QR code, value, amount of my coins, and then a send and receive transaction screen here. And you can set the fees or the gas limit in your transaction and send it like this. The third tier I want to talk about is community level security. Now, this maybe isn't traditional security, but I think it still needs to be considered in the same sphere. So what do I mean by the developer community? Well, if we think about wallets, the developers are the people that make the wallets and post the apps in the Play Store or the App Store. We download them and use them, and there's an implicit trust there that what we are downloading and using is going to do exactly what it says, and there won't be any privacy breaches, there won't be any key leaks, nobody will have access to our keys other than who we allow, and so on and so forth. You want to be confident that the software you're using is honest and true and does exactly what it's supposed to and nothing more. Additionally, you don't want there to be any sort of backdoors or security holes in there that attackers could find and fill. So in this sense, it's very important to be aware of what software you're using. If you're downloading software, you want to make sure that you run a checksum on the software to make sure that the version you're using hasn't been updated by an attacker. Okay, you want to make sure that the software is regularly updated. So check out, you know, the GitHub or the repository to see the developer activity. And you also want to keep your software up to date. So as OSs and systems evolve, software can develop security holes even without being touched. And so you want to make sure that you always are updating your apps. In terms of the mining community here, what I mean by this is that The miners also play an important role here. Some people say that it's the miners that maintain the security in the network, and that's because the miners are validating all of the transactions. And if there is a transaction that doesn't fit the requirements, then that transaction does not get included. So if somebody tries to double spend their coins, that transaction won't get included. And so the mining community does play a large role. And we talked about 51% attacks and what happens with large conglomerates. So if a mining pool gets really, really big, that mining pool could exert influence such as what version of software they're using. And so that could be another form where a certain mining community is using a different version of software. And that could represent a security consideration as well. Smart contracts, this is a huge area for breaches and hacks. Decentralized finance, or DeFi, has been hacked a lot so far in 2020. And we'll talk more about smart contracts in a future session. Exchanges and scams. Okay, this is the good stuff. This is the entertaining stuff. So let's have a look. So exchanges are where a lot of the activity in cryptocurrencies reside, and they are also centralized, and they represent a massive, massive target because of the value of cryptocurrency that goes through them. And as you might expect, exchanges have been hacked. So one of the most famous is Mt. Gox, and that's because it was early, March 2014, 850,000 Bitcoins were stolen from Mt. Gox, and this case is still ongoing now, 6 years later. This amount of Bitcoin is currently worth more than $6 billion USD, and this is from 2 years ago, 2018. So that is kind of the biggest and the most famous. Now, also in this list, if we look at 2019, this is just last year, there is an exchange called Cryptopia here. Cryptopia, so this was a Christchurch-based cryptocurrency exchange. And you know, on January 13th, users could not access their accounts, and they lost, in this first batch, about 20,000 ETH. And then there was another breach a few days later. 15 days later. So people think that this was an inside job because the attacker basically had direct knowledge of the company's private keys. So the exchange also needs private keys to store people's cryptocurrency. And these keys are usually stored in a combination of cold storage, which is offline, so there's no access via the web, and hot storage, which is online. And that would be for quick settlement, whereas cold storage would be for maybe settling daily or even in longer time periods, having an amount offline. Anyways, the whole story of Cryptopia has not yet come out yet. Another interesting story is about Quadriga. So Quadriga was a Canadian cryptocurrency exchange. Here we go. You know the story. Dead CEO, 190 million of customer funds missing, mismanagement, conspiracy. So this one is also still ongoing. And people think that the owner, here he is, Gerald Cotton, people think that the owner faked his own death. He went to India on, I believe, a meditation type of retreat, and he never returned home. The story is that he had a heart attack while he was there. At least that's what the Indian death certificate says. And his body was never brought home either. He was buried in India. So he left his wife with this exchange, but she didn't have any access to the private keys. Apparently, Cotton, you know, took them with him right to his grave. And so his wife could not help. And she is also, she's cooperating, but I believe she's also being held responsible. So this page just has a podcast about this catastrophic crypto caper. Moving on, let's look at some of the most famous scams. So scams will never go away. These are, you know, a tale as old as time. So this one's called BitConnect. And this is what the chart looks like for a pyramid scheme. So in the early days, these BitConnect tokens, you know, were worth $10, $12, and there weren't that many in them. But the idea with BitConnect is that they were promising a set amount of interest. So they were promising 120% interest a year. So that's pretty darn good return, right? 120% interest in a year. And they said that they had a guaranteed algorithm that would pay out interest in daily amounts. So you invest a bunch of tokens and you get daily payouts. And the payouts in the early days were big, like 1-3% per day of compounded interest. And as more and more people got in on it and more people signed up, the value went up. And they would use the increasing value to make payouts against the earlier people that got in. In the later days, we can see some extreme volatility here. This dip is when you knew something, well, people knew a long time ago that something was up, but this dip is when people were really scared and you don't know when the scheme is gonna stop paying out. And what happens here is that the funders or the people in first, they start to disappear. And in about 24 or 48 hours here, it went from $300, you know, down to less than 30. And now it's essentially worthless. So that was one of the most publicized scams. You can still check out some videos on YouTube. Speaking of which, another scam is famous by this BBC podcast just last year, The Missing Crypto Queen, by journalist Jamie Bartlett. And this is all about the OneCoin scam, which was more prominent in the UK and Europe and China. Now, OneCoin was a cryptocurrency that promised to be better than Bitcoin. And they also promised, you know, massive monetary gains, buy in now, and within a certain number of time, it will be worth X. And so just to give you an idea of what this one looked like, let's play a clip of this person, Dr. Ruja.
Great time.
So we've got some sandstorm here.
I am too. So we have heard so many good speakers on stage today, but this is only the beginning. Remember, we're here for a reason.
So I'm going to go forward to this point.
Applause, please.
This girl is on fire.
Ruja, where are you? Ruja.
I mean, there's literal smoke and fire here to distract people from being separated from their money. This is exactly what a scam looks like. There we go, OneCoin, the Bitcoin killer. And so this person, Ruja, hasn't been seen, I think, since 2017. So she disappeared by a conservative estimate, about $4 billion was absorbed by this OneCoin scam. They promised a blockchain, and in fact, there was actually no blockchain when all was said and done. In the early days, they were just keeping track of people's coins with a spreadsheet. They didn't even have a network doing it. It got big really fast, and so apparently they tried to go legit, but it grew too fast for them to handle. And lastly, some news. This happened just on Tuesday morning, was the third Bitcoin halving. So every 4 years, or every 210,000 blocks that get processed by the network, the block subsidy, that's the Coinbase reward, gets cut in half. So it started at 50, down to 25, down to 12.5, and now it's down to 6.25. So this happened on Tuesday morning, so this was a pretty big event for Bitcoin. If we have a look here in the Explorer, so at height 629,999, this is Tuesday morning here, the UTC time, the block reward was 12.5. And the very next block, we can just change the address bar here. The very next block processed had half of the block reward, so 6.25 bitcoins. And so this is a major event. It kind of signals the next epic or the next 4 years in Bitcoin, and all of the mining economics of being able to produce new bitcoins is going to shift, because you don't earn as much depending on the price that you're selling at and the price that the input electricity you're paying for is at. You don't earn as much as you used to. So literally overnight, miners are making, in terms of fiat money or in terms of cashing into dollars, they're making half as much as they were the day before. So the feeling is that a lot of the smaller miners are going to have to go out of business, and a lot of the older mining equipment is going to immediately be obsolete. It just won't be profitable anymore to mine. And this will continue for the next 100-odd years in Bitcoin, eventually eroding away completely and leaving the network to run entirely on fees. Okay, so that was a major event for cryptocurrencies and blockchains this week. So that wraps it up for me for today. I will catch you in the live stream shortly.